This morning I'm here to familiarize you on the history and ethics of the tobacco industry. As we all know, there's several ways to use tobacco, whether it be smoke it, cigars, cigarettes, or smokeless or chewed tobacco, different types of which, hookah, cloves, filter cigarettes, pipes, and the first lie the tobacco industry feeds to us that's easy to believe is that some of these are less dangerous than others. With labels on our packages such as light or high filter or things like that, make it seem like there's a healthier alternative, but in reality, they're all cancer-causing, they're all they all contain toxins, cancer, lung cancer, oral cancer, chronic bronchitis, emphysema, and all addiction, of course. So today I'm here to talk about types of tobacco, just social places to buy and smoke tobacco, how the tobacco industry advertises, how they use propaganda, how they use media to influence their selling of their product, a little bit of the history of the industry in our culture, and some of the effects on smoking. These are a few things that are contained in cigarettes, namely, just one way to smoke tobacco, one way to use tobacco. Lead, arsenic, polonium, cadmium, carbon monoxide, some of these things I haven't heard of, but cadmium is contained in batteries, car batteries, normal, just like AA, AAA kind of batteries. Carbon monoxide, arsenic is found in poisons, rat poison namely, and just to name a few of these things. And so those are all in cigarettes and just whatever kind of pack of cigarettes you buy. Smokeless tobacco or chew, sometimes seen as healthier or less dangerous, less detrimental to your health. But actually, smokeless tobacco, according to the CDC or the Center for Disease Control, smokeless tobacco, chew tobacco actually consumes these contents of the tobacco three times faster, right? Chew tobacco using it in your mouth than it does smoking. It's actually three times more dangerous to your health. That's hookah. We've all seen anyway. That's kind of this. I put this picture on here because it's a little bit more. This is kind of a social way that a lot of people like to smoke. There's hookah bars and lounges all around, and so it's kind of it seems more. Or a social, more fun way to smoke and less dangerous, less. This way is one way the industry makes us think that it's a little less dangerous for our health and a little more just fun and kind of interesting. Now I'm going to talk about a little bit of the history of the tobacco industry and how it plays in our culture. In 1952, tobacco and smoking, namely, was seen a lot in movies, commercials, TV shows. Everyone was always smoking. It was really cool. Prior to then, people didn't really know how unhealthy it was for us. They just thought it was normal. It was just, and that's what the tobacco industry wanted, to trick us into thinking, or actually to not tell us the dangers of smoking. So before 1952, that's what people thought. But in 1952, lung cancer was linked to smoking in the Reader's Digest article, and then soon after the New York Times and Good Housekeeping and magazines and articles like that. And so, of course, sales began to decline, tobacco sales, smoking sales, and the movies and media began to have less actors and less movie stars being smoking in movies. And the tobacco industry didn't know quite what to do because people were realizing that this habit, this smoking was linked with lung cancer, and that's just one thing that's linked with we started to find out about. So the tobacco industry turns to someone named John Hill. John Hill was a lawyer, and he says he was not out to outsmart the American public by helping the tobacco industry build profits. But today, he's still in court facing criminal charges on exactly doing that, outsmarting the American public by helping the tobacco industry boost profits. So the tobacco industry is trying to respond to this sales and decline as any industry would. And that year, the tobacco industry spent $42 million just in building a program to get their sales back up, to get their advertising back in the industry, back in the media, which led to the U.S. Congress Federal Cigarette Labeling and Advertising Act of 1965, and also the Public Health Cigarette Smoking Act of 1969. This act bans cigarette advertising in media. It provided a health warning on cigarette packages, the Surgeon General's warning, and also called for an annual report on the health consequences of smoking. So this was also another diss on the tobacco industry that didn't quite know how to handle it again. And now it's illegal to advertise, and so they respond again, trying to figure out ways to sneak back into the media, sneak back into advertising, to get their product out there and make it less than how unhealthy it is. They did this by debating with companies, debating with media, debating with everyone, trying to shift the focus from their unhealthy product between how it causes cancer, and try to shift the focus and argue. What they argue was that if someone is willing to buy the cigarette knowing that how unhealthy it is, that they should be able to. It's their personal freedom here in America. It's their responsibility. Since the Advertising Act, they have the Surgeon General's warning, so it's their responsibility to read and know the effects of smoking, so that should be their freedom to smoke and to buy the cigarette. Also, they advertise, or they convinced us that advertising was necessary, that it was their product and it should be their freedom to advertise their product just as anyone else does. And advertise. 1991, the industry spent $3.3 million to influence the public in advertising. Since 1987, since 1987, big tobacco industries have increased their sales $236.7 million as in 2001. So obviously somehow they got their way back in the media in advertising. After the Advertising Act of 1965 was banned, the advertising of cigarettes, the CDC, Centers for Disease Control, is what did that. The tobacco industry responds with an advertising repeal in 1969. Advertising is necessary to inform customers. This is a tobacco industry representative. And so since then, advertising is now obviously seen. How many ads do you see a day about cigarettes? How many billboards do you see about tobacco, or really propaganda using cigarettes, using smoking on movies, television? It's all back in there. And even though we all know it's dangerous now and that it's been leaked, all the dangers of it, it's still back in the media. So tobacco industry is back at it more than ever, as you see the numbers here. Revenues from smokeless tobacco. That's just smokeless tobacco. Chew. It isn't even, not really that popular. $1.99 billion in 2011, $2.13 billion in 2001. Just some quick facts on tobacco, the industry, the causes, the effects of it. I just thought these were some interesting quotes. Some of these are quotes from Truth.com, some of these are quotes from actual tobacco industry executives and representatives. I thought they were really interesting. One's not up there. One tobacco industry executive was quoted as saying, if proven to his satisfaction that cooked smoking caused cancer, then he would quit his job and reevaluate things. But now, on the tobacco industry's website, it states that it causes cancer, so they're definitely still in business. One tobacco company proposed reaching its target consumer from ice cream trucks. In 1988, one tobacco company brainstormed the idea of a colored cigarette to enhance wardrobe. Acetic acid is found in cigarettes. That's a rat poison. Those are some other poisons. Those are all four of those are poisons found in just cigarette smoking alone. That's a picture that an idea that the tobacco industry thought of once. I don't think I've ever seen it, but they actually had a meeting about this. And that was an idea, and I just thought that was ridiculous. So you guys kill over 50.